Good morning. It's 10 o'clock. And this is week 9. 4 more weeks to go. Right, so I'm going to release the midterm test result later on Gradebook. And then the idea is that we are not going to give you back the script, okay, the paper that you bring home, but we are going to organize a session. That means this Friday, I'm going to book a discussion room. I'll make the announcement. So what you are going to do is that you can come individually or in a group to come and view your script, okay, to see what is the marking or how marks are given to you and how marks are deducted. You can ask questions. You can, you know, talk about how those problems can be solved and that kind of things. Okay, we use the whiteboard to explain. Yeah. But remember, the session is not for you to argue for more marks. We have already looked at the thing, the mistake that we make, we have already taken care of. Okay, so that if you say, come there, and then you say, that, oh, I should get more marks for this, I will look at your answer in more detail, more carefully, and I will deduct more marks. Because for looking for more mistake is easier than, you know, giving you the extra marks that you are looking for. Okay, so you come with this mindset that I'm going to learn from my mistake. Okay, what mistake I make during the midterm test? How I can improve, and not come and argue for more marks. Okay, that is not for the purpose of the session. Right. The other thing is don't ask me for statistics. Don't ask me what is the average of this midterm test. The idea is that doesn't help you. Okay, people say, I have to know where I stand. Then I will try to improve and that kind of things. It doesn't work that way. Okay, long time ago, when I was telling students their average, you know, nobody will be happy, except those who score very high, you know. If you are below average, you say, die liao, you know. So many people are above me, right? Even if you are 1 point above average, you are still not very happy. I'm just above average. No, there are so many people who score better than me. That's why the average like that. Okay? So don't ask for the average and tell me that you are going to improve because you know where you stand, and so therefore you can improve. Okay? You only want to ask this question: why I did not do as good as well as I expected, right? I have put in effort, but I didn't do well. Why? Okay, then you might want to ask question whether your study method is correct or you really didn't really put in a lot of effort. So you want to put in more effort. I think those are the questions that you want to ask. Okay, so Friday, check the announcement. Then just find a time that you can come. Friday is the tutorial day, right? So after your tutorial, you can just come over, okay? Right, so today we want to complete the discussion on recursion. And then if we have time, we will go on to talk about the complexity analysis. Right, so we have already started recursion last week. And we know that recursive algorithm basically is a method that calls itself, because the problem is recursive in nature. And the problem itself can be solved by breaking it down into smaller problems of the same kind. So therefore, you can use a method that calls itself to solve the problem. Right, so we know that factorial is one of those recursive problems, because factorial can be defined in terms of itself. Okay, so we want to see how the recursive work or recursion work in computer. Okay, when you make recursive call. Right, so you can view it something like this. You can trace it. Sometimes tracing the recursive call is like you are winding it up and then you unwind it later on. Right? I don't know whether you all have some at home, those old type of alarm clock. You know, they use something, the spring kind of alarm clock. You have to wind it up, and then after that, you just unwind, and then the clock will tick. Yeah, that kind of things. So tracing recursion is similar. So first of all, you wind it up, and then after that, you unwind it. So when you call the function or the method factorial with n equal to 5, you come inside and you check. Since n is not equal to 1, so therefore you have to go down to the recursive part where you break the problem down into smaller problem, and the smaller problem is saying that I have to multiply n, the number itself, with the result returned by the recursive call, factorial n minus 1. Right, so therefore n is equal to 5, you have to call 5 times, you have to do the statement 5 times factorial 4, which means you have to call this method one more time, factorial 4. And the same thing when you go into this copy with n equal to 4, it is not equal to 1, so therefore you have to call factorial 3. So you wind it up again to factorial 2, factorial 1, and eventually when you make this call, n is equal to 1. Yeah. So you reach the anchor case, the base case. So when n is equal to 1, you return 1. So therefore, you unwind. Okay, you return 1. And of course, you have completed this current copy. When you go back to the previous call, you have to complete that copy also, right? So in that call, you still need to get the result back from the subsequent call. You have to multiply the local variable. Okay, at this moment, in this copy, n is equal to 2. Right, so therefore, 2 times 1, you are going to return 2. Okay, the same thing, you go back to the previous copy, you have to multiply this result returned by the subsequent call with the local n, and at the moment, n is equal to 3. Yeah, n is equal to 3, so therefore, you have to return 6, and so on. Yeah, so 4 times 6, 24. 24 times 5 is 120, and you reach the top level call. And that is the result you return to the calling method. You return 120. So that is how you trace a recursive call. Yeah, you just need to do something like that. Of course, this is a very simple recursive problem. You can see it like that. Later on, you are going to see some more complicated problem, right? So maybe it's not so straightforward tracing like this, but you can use other way to do it. Okay, we will see. Right, so we say that it is easy to visualize the execution of non-recursive call, right? Because it's actually sequential, you do it step by step. You can use some memory snapshot to actually say, oh, this is A, I put some value inside there, this is B, I put some value inside there. You can just do this. It's very easy to trace. But it can be confusing when you are doing recursion, okay? Because each call actually generate a new copy of the function, right, with the local variable, right? So you have to know for this particular copy, what is the value of the local variable and so on. You have to remember all this, right? Right, so in this case, if we want, we can actually use one of the ADT that we have just discussed to help us to visualize. Okay, so the question is, what is this? If you want to visualize how recursive work, we have already keep saying that you have to keep the current copy on top of something and then you make a recursive call to the next copy and so on, right? So I'm sure you can answer this question. If this come out in the final exam, the answer is stack, right? So you have to put the current copy on the stack, make a new copy and send the control into the new copy and do execution there. Once that copy is completed, you finish execution there, you pop something out of the stack and restore the local variable inside this current copy, and then continue to execute whatever statements that are left behind. Yeah. Right, so you can also use a stack to visualize, like for example, factorial, right? So again, you call factorial 5 inside the main program, and eventually you want to store this result into J. Yeah. Right, so n is equal to 5, you push the you push the local copy, the local variable, n into the stack. So for this copy, there's only one value, so you push the 5 inside there, right? And then you call factorial 4. And for this copy, you push the 4 inside there, and then you call 3, you call 2, you call 1, okay? So when you have reached n equal to 1, you just return 1. That means this copy has been executed. So you can just return the value. Throw this from the stack and then pop up the next copy that you have to execute. right? So you return the result to the previous copy, multiply it to the local variable and return the result again. Okay, so then you assign the result to J, which is done inside the main program. Okay, so the idea is you can use either way to do this, sometimes maybe you can also visualize it differently. Like for example, instead of putting a stack like this, you can actually say, okay, this is actually the n equal to 5. Right, then you call, because it's, you have to call n, you have to say 5 times this guy, which is n equal to 4. And then you have to say 4 times this guy, which is n equal to 3. You can do something like that. So this is actually a stack, but you are just putting, you know, pieces of paper on top of each other. Up to you. Okay, so when you reach one, you just go to the next one, get next level, and so on. Okay, so many different ways of visualizing recursive execution. Right, so this is important. Okay, I want you all to remember this. To formulate a recursive solution, as I said at the beginning, you need to figure out that this problem is actually recursive in nature, right? So we say that first of all, you have to be able to find the what they call general case, meaning that be able to break the problem down into smaller problem, and the smaller problem is exactly the same as the original problem, except that it is smaller, okay, in terms of maybe the size of the problem or number of elements and the kind of things, right? So we say that this is what we call the general recursive case, okay? Identify a simpler problem, right? So sometimes we also call this inductive step, quite similar to what we call proof by induction, okay? When you have mathematics theory, right, to prove something, okay, you prove by induction. And then you have to identify the base case. Sometimes people call it anchor case, okay, where this is the simplest problem that you can have for this particular problem, meaning that you can solve it without calling the recursive method, okay? It's so simple that you can just do it. And then you have to ensure that your recursive call can eventually reach the anchor case or the base case. Otherwise, you're going to end up with an infinite call, right? So I call this the three-finger rules, okay? I call this the three-fingers rule. And then I when I say this, I always ask students, you know, when you take picture, you know, stand up, all of you stand up, I want to take a picture, you know, to post my on the Facebook. A lot of lecturers like to do that, the first lecture, the last lecture. Well, stand up, I'll take picture. And then students will do this, you know, especially the girl. I don't know why two fingers, why? And it's significant. Okay, so my advice to you all is next time when I ask you to, when I say take picture, instead of two fingers, you show three fingers. Okay, show three fingers, like this. Right, so this is my family photo. So you can see people show two fingers, two fingers, and okay, there are some that have 10 fingers, two fingers, two fingers, but in the middle, there's a three finger here. Of course, this three finger belongs to this guy lah. Yeah. Okay, so this is, I don't know, Chinese New Year gathering in one of the niece's house, or niece's house, right? And then after that, this is a Christmas gathering. So now you can see that there are still two finger, and so on, two fingers, but the three fingers still remain. Right, and then after that, you see there are more three fingers. more three fingers. The idea is that in the previous, they saw this picture. They asked me, what is the significance of three fingers? So I told them recursion. Of course not. I told them, oh, this is because I was a scout last time. You know, scout, when they salute, they use these three fingers, salute like that. Any scout down here? No. Yeah. Okay, I didn't explain to them. So after that, they follow, you know, they want to use three fingers. So this is my son, second son. These two are my godson. So like father, like son. And in fact, this guy is actually one of our students in SOC. Now he's in New York doing the NOC attachment. Anyway, this is just to remind you, okay? Telling you that you have to remember recursion is three fingers, okay? Why? Because this is important. It becomes one of the exam questions. So this is for 1020E for the engineering students. So Uncle Tan says that when you are taking picture, you should show three fingers instead of the usual two. He was using this to remind you of the three rules of making sure that a recursive method is good. What are the three rules? First one, there must be an inductive step, a smaller recursive step. Two, there must be an anchor case, a base case. Three, the inductive step or the recursive step must lead you to the anchor case so that the recursive call terminate. Okay, so these are the three important rules. Anytime you want to formulate a recursive algorithm, you ask yourself, do you have this? Do you satisfy these three rules? Okay, for example, do you think this is a good one? Is this a good recursion method? Of course, you say not, but what is the problem? What is the problem? Which rule is violated? Do you have a recursive call? You have, yeah, recursive call. Do you have an anchor case? You have, right? This is anchor case when n is equal to zero. Okay? Do you have the third rules that lead this to the termination? No. What happened? When n is odd number. When n is odd number, because you are going to, like for example, 5, you get minus 2, you get 3. 3 minus 2, you get 1. 1 minus 2, you get minus 1. You never reach 0. Right, so then this loop will go on, this recursive call will go on and on and on and on until you get this underflow, okay? Then it becomes positive again, maybe. Then, but you know that the result is wrong, okay? So be careful about the three rules, okay? Make sure that your algorithm satisfies these three rules, then you have a good recursive algorithm. Yeah, so this one cannot reach the base case, yeah? Okay, we want to look at more example so that you know how to use recursion to solve problem. Right, so we have done linked list. If I want to print the linked list recursively, print means printing the value inside the node, okay? So we want to print linked list, okay, and given a pointer. N is actually a pointer pointing to the node, okay, so this is a list node, okay? So, of course, when you print, you have to print everything inside there. You print until the pointer is pointing at the back. You finish printing everything, right? So, before that, if n is still not equal to now, that means you have still something to print. So, therefore, you will print out the value. And once you print out the value, you have to print the rest of the list. So, therefore, you send in the rest of the list to the same method. Because printing the rest of the list is the same as printing the linked list, right? Only thing is now the head pointer is pointing to the second node, and I send this head pointer into the method, so you will start to print the rest of the list. Okay? Visualizing this, you should see something like this. So this head, this is the linked list inside the main program, and the main program is going to call this printing linked list with the pointer equal to n. Right? So you will have this pointer coming in. So this is actually the call inside the main program, and then inside here you call this one with and pointing to this node, not equal to 5, it's pointing to the node. So you come inside here, it is not now, so therefore you print the value inside there, n.value, you print 5. Okay? And then you will go on to do this, meaning that I have to make another call, which send the rest of the list into the call, into the recursive call, right? So I send this inside there, so this is the second copy of the call. You go inside there, it is not now, because now this is pointing to this node. So therefore, you go in and print value 8, and then send in the rest of the list for printing, right? Yeah. You go inside there, not now, you print the 9, and you send in the rest of the list, which means you send in the empty list. So therefore, at this moment, the call receives an empty list. So therefore, you will just return, okay? You will just return. And then you return, and you return, and return, okay? To the previous, to the to the main program. Okay, I want to point out this. You can see that this method, receiving a result from the previous call, it will straight away return. Okay, this is what we call the tail recursion. Yeah, the terminology, tail recursion. Meaning that the recursive call is the last thing that you do inside the method. It is called tail recursion. If, however, when the recursive call returns something, you still need to perform some other method, then that recursion is not tail recursion. Okay? That's the idea. So the next one you can see, the next example. So the base case in this case is when the pointer equal to now. Yeah? And so now the question is, if I want to print this in reverse order, meaning that instead of 589, I want to print 985, how do I do it? And if you think about it, it's quite simple also, right? Printing it in the correct sequence, in the right sequence given, you just print the first one and then print the rest of the list, right? If you want to print something in reverse order, it means that the first one must be printed at the back after the rest of the list are printed, right? So what do? You just call a method to print the rest of the list. When that is done, you print the first one, right? And then this same method is going to do the same thing to the rest of the list, right? It's going to keep the head of the rest of the list and then print, call the same method again to print the rest of the list and then print the head of the list. And you can go on if you want, yeah? So that should give you the recursive method, very simple. So you cannot just simply say, oh, I changed the name of the print and then you think that it will do it for you. It's not. Okay, you change this, but this one will still print the thing in the same order. What you need to do is, based on our description, you just reverse these two statements. Alright, print the rest of the list first before you print the first element. So the first element will appear behind. And so therefore, you know, for the rest of the list, it happens the same way, you get the list printed in reverse. So same thing, so in this, you come in, it is not now. What you do, you call first. Okay, you call the rest of the list to print the rest of the list in reverse order. Still not now, you do the same thing until it is now, right? So you go back, you finish this call already, you go back to the previous call. The previous call still have one statement to do, right? So therefore, you go back and you print 9. And then this copy is done, you go back to the previous call. And the previous call has still one more statement to do, you print 8. And you are done with this, you go back to the previous call print out 5. And this is what we call tail recursion. Okay, because when this guy is done, there's one more statement to do. There's one more statement to do. So this is not tail recursive. Okay? What happens if I want to insert something into the linked list? And this linked list is supposed to be sorted. Okay, meaning that you, after the insertion, the value in the list will still be inserted. Sorted. Yeah, how do I do it? So if you think about it, as we say many times, with linked list, you draw the picture, then you ask yourself, okay, what should I do? You have to take care of all the possible cases. 1, 5, 8, 10, 12, let's say. So there are a few things that you can do, right? I can insert maybe 4 down here. I want to insert the 3, that means I insert to the front of the list. If I want to insert a 9, I want to insert in between 2 nodes. If I want to insert 13, I will be inserting at the back, right? So I ask myself, how do I do this recursively? So the idea is, of course, when you want to make sure that it is sorted after the insertion, you need to find the insertion point, right? So do you need to go through a for loop to find the insertion point first? If that's the case, you are not doing recursive algorithm. So you ask yourself, what happens if I look at the first node and the value is already smaller than the value inside the first node? We know that we are supposed to insert it in front. Yeah. Otherwise, I will consider the rest of the list to be a new list for me to insert the new value, right? So more or less, I cut this off. Like for example, I want to insert 9. I cut this off and send this in to be a new list for me to insert the new value. And when this new when this insertion is done, when it comes back with the new list, I just attach this new list back to this node. And I'm done. Correct or not? Okay, so if you think about it, this is what the recursive algorithm is about, right? When I want to insert to the rest of the list, this is exactly the same problem as the original list. The only thing now is I send in the second nodes as the head of the list, and then I call the insertion again. Okay, and if I'm inserting to the last node, that the pointer that I send it in is actually a null pointer. So you are going to create a new node, and then when this return, you just set this null pointer to point to this, and you have inserted the thing. Okay, so if you think about it, this P is the pointer to the first node. The V is the value that you want to insert. Okay, and you can view this as the first node and the rest of the list. Okay, this is the first node, and then the rest of the list is like that. So what you do, if P is equal to null, that means either at the beginning you have an empty list, so therefore you are supposed to create a new node and return this as a new list, or you actually come to the last situation where you are already at the end of the list. As we say just now, again you create a new list and then just return this new list to be a list that you have inserted this value, so that the previous call can attach this new list back to the pointer. Okay, so this is tail insertion when P is equal to null. When V is smaller than the element pointed to by this pointer, so we have to insert before this, right? Because if you want it to be sorted, for example, this guy is 5 and then V is equal to 4. So we know that you are supposed to insert this new value in front of this list, and then you return the pointer, this pointer as the new list. Okay, that is what you're supposed to do. And finally, when V is greater or equal to the value inside here, then we can say that we take this guy out and cut this, as we say just now, and make this to become a new list where the value is supposed to be inserted. And when this insertion is done, it's going to return the new list. What I need to do is attach this back to this pointer, and the value will be inserted to the original list. Okay? So if you analyze it this way, writing this program becomes very simple, meaning that you just have if statement to take care of this, if statement to take care of this, and if statement to take care of this. And sometimes you are going to find that, some of this can be combined together, right? So you can see that you are going to get something like this, meaning that when P is equal to null, or if V is actually less than the value, right? So when P is equal to null, meaning that the pointer is pointing to null. When V is less than this, meaning that the pointer is pointing to the first node. Right, so for this one, you are inserting in front so that this is equal to null. For this one, you are inserting in front also so that this is pointing to here. Okay, so you can actually combine these two cases together into one case under one if statement. So if P is equal to null, or V is smaller than the value, you are inserting in front of the list. Okay, so you just return this new list where you are using the second constructor of the list node, so that this, when this is constructed, it is already pointing to here, and when this is constructed, this is already pointing to there, right? And you can return this pointer to the previous call, and the previous call will attach this pointer to the next of the nodes that you use to send the thing. Yeah. Otherwise, you are sending it, you are inserting it to the middle. So as we say, you have already cut this off, and then send this guy into the second call, right? So in this case, it is going to be inserted somewhere inside, and it is going to return, and then you have to attach this. So we can see that we are sending in P next. P is down here. P next is this whole thing. When the insertion is done, you send this pointer back, the pointer of the new list back. You just attach it to this P next again. So you will insert the new list behind the nodes. Okay. And of course, again inside there, this is a recursive call, which is similar to this. You might have to go on and on and on, and then eventually you might be inserting at the back. Okay, so this is a very simple recursive algorithm. You can see that when you see a recursive algorithm, when implementing it, it's very simple, very simple. That's why we keep telling the student for PE, the second question is 70%, And before that, CE Lab, we haven't tested you on recursion. So therefore, you are supposed to do recursion for the second question, 70%. So if you just need to write a fine statement to implement it, how long do you need to implement this? 5 minutes, right? Yeah, but you have 2.5 hours for PE. Of course, there's a 30% question, which actually we want you to practice complexity analysis. Okay, so normally this question is actually easier to implement, but the formulation part is more difficult. You have to analyze, you have to know what are the recursive call, what are the parameter to pass, and that kind of things. Okay, so again, we just want to tell you, okay, PE, you want to spend more time analyzing it so that you can find an easy recursive call. Okay, so this is just to prove to you. A complicated program or math problem, the implementation is so simple. Right, to call this method in the main program, you just say head equal to insert head, right? You insert starting from the first node. And when it is done, you just point the head to the first node, okay, because you might be inserting to the front, yeah? Right, so you go to any modules that discuss recursion, this problem will always be used. Okay, no discussion on the recursion is complete without talking about this problem. So tower your high noise. Yeah. So we know that there's this story, right? Or legend that once upon a time there was this mountain in Hanoi, right? And in the mountain there was this temple, and in the temple there was this old monk, and the old monk was trying out this puzzle or this this thing, okay? He's trying to move 64 discs, put on top one on top of the other, from one pole to the other, using the third one to be the auxiliary pole or pad, yeah? And the legend is saying that, I have to give the condition, if the old man actually complete this thing that he's trying to do, that will be the end of the world. So you better pray that this old monk don't finish this, otherwise it will be the end of the world. Okay? To do this, the old monk has to follow two rules, okay, two conditions. One is that at any one point, he can only move one disc from one pole to the other. Okay? The second condition is he cannot put the bigger disc on top of the smaller disc. Only these two conditions, right? So just imagine there are 64 discs. The old monk can get very confused. Okay, move here, move there, then you don't know. Okay. So therefore, you are supposed to write a program to help him. You are supposed to write a program to say, okay, move this from A to B, move this from A to C, move this from B to C, you know, a sequence of statement so that the old monk can just follow. Okay? Hopefully he can end the world faster. Okay, so the rules is that you can only move one disc at a time, and then that is a second one, right? The largest one cannot be put on the second smaller one. So you can do something like this, and then you put this one on top. And then after that, of course, you move the bigger one over here, and then move the smaller one there, move the bigger one there, and then move the one on top, and you are done. Okay? So we call this the initial state, and this the final state. Okay, how do you achieve this? Right, so if you think about it, can we make this to become a recursive algorithm? Subsequently, you are going to find that if you don't make this to be a recursive algorithm, it is actually very difficult to solve the problem. Okay, very difficult. You want to do it iteratively, you have to simulate the recursive call inside your program. Okay, so in this case, we want to see what happens if I only want this. Meaning that now I want to I have only one disc. I want to move this from here to here. What should I do? I just simply move there, and then I'm done, right? Okay? What happens if I have two? If I have two, I know that I'm supposed to move this one there, move this one there, and move this one up. I'm done. Yeah. So, in general, we figure out that we can actually do something like this. we can consider this, the biggest one, to be one disk, and then this n minus 1 to be a sub-problem. Okay? And we say that if the final state is supposed to be using pole B to hold the final stack, what I want to do is I move this one to here. And after that, I move this one here. And finally, I move the 3 on top of the biggest one. And I will solve the problem, okay? When I'm doing this analysis, I do not worry about how I do this first step. This is step 1, moving the n minus 1 from A to C, right? The second step is to move one, the biggest one, from A to B. And finally, I move the n minus 1 from C to B. And that will solve the original problem of moving n from A to B, right? Yeah. Then, of course, then you ask yourself, what happens if I want to move this n minus 1 from here to here? What is the difference between the original problem and this current problem, the smaller problem? It is smallest because it's n minus 1, right? The difference is this is still the original stack, and the goal is to move it down here. For the original one, the goal is to move it down here, right? So now the goal is to move this one down here, and then move the largest one, and I will have another sub-problem. To move from C to B, I need to move it back because that is the third step in the analysis, right? Right, and you find that moving this 3 from here to here and moving this 3 from here to here are the same problem, exactly the same. Only thing is it is smaller now and the target is different. The pole, the original, the source, and the destination are different. So therefore, you know that you can actually call the same recursive method, just changing the value. And you solve the problem. Right, so in this case, we know that there's only one, the best case is, the base case is equal to one disk, okay? You just simply move it to the target. And the inductive step is n minus one disk, right? N minus one disk, okay? And how many steps do I need to do to call the inductive step? There will be two of them, right? There will be two of them. Right, so if you think about it with the analysis, the algorithm is exactly what we said. Okay, so if there's only one disk, then I can just simply move it from the source to the destination. I just print this statement. Right, move one disk from A to B. That is an anchor case. Otherwise, I have to first of all solve the first subproblem. Okay, the first subproblem is to move n minus one disk from the source. You see, this is your, like for example, this is your A, this is your B, and this is your C, yeah? The source, the destination, and the temporary pole, yeah? So, this N minus 1, this is actually the first sub-problem is on A. And I want to move it to C, right? Because I'm going to have this new target to move this N minus 1 to C. But at the moment, C is actually the temp, right? So the sub-problem, the destination is actually C, so therefore, it is supposed to be temp. The original temp, right? And I'm supposed to use B to be my temporary pole. So I put the destination, which is down, which is B down here. Okay? So the first sub-problem is to move N minus 1 disk from source to the temporary pole of the original problem. Okay? And the second sub-problem is to move one disk from the source to the destination of the original problem. Yeah? So therefore, one disk from source, which is A, destination, which is B, and using the C as the temporary pole. Okay, and finally, I'm supposed to move the n minus 1 disk from the temporary pole of the original problem to the destination. Right, so therefore, n minus 1 disk, this is the C, now this sub-problem starting point is here. The destination is the same as the original problem, and I'm using the source to be a temporary pole. Can you understand this? Yeah, so you just need to figure out the parameters for recursive call. And then you do not need to worry about tracing this. Okay, of course you can try if you want to trace this. Okay, use small number of this and you can trace it. But I would advise that you do not need to worry. If you can convince yourself that your analysis is correct, right, that you can actually do this, then you just write it and the program will do it for you. Okay, so what you want to do is copy this into a program and then just try it with 4, with 5 and see the list coming out And then you just try to follow whether this program gives you the correct instruction. Imagine that you are the old monk in Hanoi. Right, so the question is this. I have this, let's say three only. Can I divide this problem into sub-problem like this? Meaning that I consider one this here, and then the n minus one to be the bottom numbers, to be the bottom list. Is this possible? I understand what I'm trying to say. Just now we show you the correct way. We can move n minus one to the temporary pole first, move the largest one to the destination, and move n minus one from the temporary pole to the destination. So I want to find out whether I can also divide the problem, break the problem down into smaller problem like this. Okay, one this, and n minus one this. Okay, so I move this one to the temporary pole, then I move this one over there, and then I move this one up. Is this possible? Is it possible? No. Why? Okay, because the idea is, after you move this one here, fine. But when you want to move this one over there, you have to put something into some temporary, you have to put this one into the temporary pole again, which means you are going to put, like for example, this is one, two, three, right? You are supposed to go and put two on top of one, which violate the second rules, that you cannot put the biggest value on top or bigger this on top of the smaller this, right? So therefore, this way of breaking the problem down into smaller problem is impossible because you are violating the rules, right? So that's what I'm trying to tell you. When you analyze a problem, you have to analyze it such that the breaking down of the problem is according to the rules, satisfy whatever the requirement of the problem before you continue to try to implement it, okay? Right, so just now I said already, you can see that this is a difficult problem. Once you analyze it and you come up with this algorithm already, implementing is very simple, right? So you have one statement, two statement, three statement, four, five, six, including the what they call method heading, total seven, okay? Because it's recursive, you implement it in recursive algorithm or recursive method is very simple. If you want to, however, use iterative solution to do it, you are going to find it very difficult. Not difficult, but very tedious. You have to do a lot of things yourself. And this is how you do it. You have to simulate the recursive call by using stack. Okay, we say stack can be used to simulate, right? So in this case, what is going to happen? First of all, you have to have four stack. One stack to store the number of this. One stack to store the source, the A. One stack to store the B, and one stack to store the C. Okay, because these are the argument that you are going to give to the recursive call, right? The recursive call, the parameter include the number of this, the source, the destination, and the temporary pole. You have to tell the recursive call, and you have to simulate it by using stack. Of course, you might want to say, oh, I don't want to use four stack, I want to use only one. Can you create a stack that store four things inside? The number of this, the source, the destination, and the temporary pole. Make it to become a class, right? An object you can store, right? But you still have a stack of object rather than stack of four different items, okay? You can do that. Right, so this is to show you how you can use a stack to solve this kind of problem. For other example that we have, maybe in SIGIN lab or in take-home lab, you might want to do the same thing, right? Create an empty stack, and then after that, you're going to go through the for loop until the stack becomes empty. Create an empty queue, put the first thing inside there, and then you want to go through a for loop until the queue becomes empty, right? So those are normal way of doing things, huh? So exactly the same as this. So at the beginning, we know that we have this n, number of this, I put it into the first stack, okay, zero. The original, for example, in this case, A, so I put the thing, okay, so this is zero, A, B, and C. Okay, so this four step initialize the situation, the current, the initial state of the problem, right? And then step top plus plus, meaning that now it is actually pointing to the first element. Before that, step top was zero, yeah? And as I say, while the step top is still greater than zero, that means there are still problems inside the stack for me to continue to solve, right? So what do? You pop the current one of the thing so that you can look at use zero to do it, right? So num this is equal to zero, the first tag. The source is equal to A. Destination is equal to B. And the temp is equal to C. So you take the thing out from the stack. So the stack becomes empty. And what you do? You check whether this is equal to 1. If it is equal to 1, this is the anchor case. So you just print the statement to say that I move from source to destination, 1 this. Okay? Otherwise, it is not the anchor case. So what do? You simulate the breaking it down into 3 sub-problems. And we know that if we have the 3 sub-problems, right, so you have the biggest one, and then this n minus 1 we are supposed to put there, and this one go there, and this guy go up, right? So this is supposed to be 1, 2, 3. We are supposed to execute this one first, right? So what do? You have to put the third sub-problem into the stack, into the bottom of the stack, because we have 3 sub-problems. Right, you have to put them into the stack so that we can do it one by one. Okay, now. So therefore, I need to put this guy inside the stack first. And then I put this guy on top of the first sub-problem. And finally, I put this sub-problem on top of the stack so that when I pop it out, I will do this sub-problem first. Yeah. So that is what happened down here. Right, so number of this is equal to 1, the temp. Okay, so the idea is this. The third sub-problem, we say already, right? So this one, this is the first sub-problem, second sub-problem, the third sub-problem is to do this, right? So this is your temp, this is your destination, and this is your source. Right? So in this case, the third sub-problem, the destination is this guy, right? I'm sorry, the source is this guy. Right? So therefore, you have to put the temporary pole of the original problem into the stack for the source. Right, the destination is the same. So therefore, you put the destination of the original problem into the stack for destination. Okay, and finally, because you are trying to use this source to be your temporary pole for this sub-problem, so therefore, you have to put the source into the stack for temporary pole. So these 3 steps down here, or these 4 steps down here, created a sub-problem that you put in the bottom of the stack to say that this is the third sub-problem. Okay. And this one is to put the second problem, this guy. Okay, to move one this from source to destination. So therefore, you have one this. Yeah? The source is still equal to the source. The destination is still equal to the destination. The temporary pole is still equal to the temporary pole. Okay, so that is the second sub-problem you put on top of the third sub-problem. And finally, you put this sub-problem on top of the stack. Yeah? N minus one this. The source is still the same. The source is still the source. Now the target is this guy. Right? So the destination is supposed to be the temporary pole of the original problem. And finally, the temporary pole is actually the destination of the original problem. Can you see this? Okay. So you have to create these 3 sub-problems yourself and then put them onto the stack. And once you have done that, there will be 3 sub-problems inside there, right? And you will go back to this while loop. And then you pop up the first sub-problem, and you try to do it, and you continue. Okay, put in 3 more sub-problems on top, and then when you finish these three sub-problems, you will do the second sub-problem or the original problem until you finish. Okay, so you are supposed to do this using stack to simulate the recursive call of the recursive algorithm. Not difficult, but you just consider that you have to type all these things as compared to the 7-9. Of course, the recursive algorithm is better, right? The only problem is recursive call make use of the internal stack, right? And the internal stack is using the memory which is actually given inside the stack memory. Okay, you can run out of stack memory after a while, so you have to be careful about that. You have to find out how much memory are reserved for stack before you create your recursive call. Yeah. Which version run faster? Of course, the iterative version. Okay, you do not need to do a lot of housekeeping. Right, so if you think in terms of efficiency, why is it that if this old monk finished the task, it's going to be the end of the world? The idea is if you have 64 days, it's going to take 584 million years to complete. You start now. I don't know how many generations of the old monk. This old monk have a young man. Right, so he finished before he finished, he gone already, then this guy take over. And then before he finished, he gone already, and then I take. So total had to do 584 billion years. So do you think it's going to be the end of the world? Most likely. Okay, this is not so important to us. It's not within our lifetime, so you do not need to worry about this. What you are supposed to worry is this. If inside the test, inside the exam, I ask you this question. Okay, if I have 10 days, what is the 512 move? What is the 512 move? Moving from where to where? Only moving one disc. You know what is the 512 move? How do you answer this question? Right, so if you think about it, it's actually not so evil. You think we are very evil asking you this kind of question during exam. And this one is actually a multiple choice question, 3 marks only. So if you try to go and simulate this, moving one, then like that, you are going to take maybe 1 hour to do it. But we know that, this is telling us what? This is 515, the sub-problem, right? When it is 7, what do you get? You get 63 plus 1 plus 63, which is actually 127, right? And then 8, you have 127 plus 1 plus 127, which is 255. And then you have 9, it's 255 plus 1 plus 255, which is 511. And then when you have 10, it's 511 plus 1 plus 511. So 512 is actually this move. And this move is what? Is to move the largest one from source to destination. So the answer will be move one disk from A to B. If the three is A, B, C, and that will be the answer. Yeah, so you should know lah. Subsequently, you also, when we talk about complexity analysis, okay, we are going to say that this big O notation, the big O notation for tau or Hainaut is actually 2 to the power n. So it's very slow. Okay, anything that is actually exponential in your algorithm, if you after you analyze it, it's 2 to the power n, it's very slow. Okay, so we don't want any algorithm developed by our student to be 2 to the power n. Okay, you shouldn't be doing that. Right. I think we take a break and then we come back to continue. 5 minutes. You know, when you learn programming, you should start young. Then you can actually do a lot. You can learn a lot, okay, when you are younger. So in the Tan family, we start the children to learn recursion very early, very early. So like, for example, when the children are going to sleep, what do? Normally the mother will read story, right? The children say, oh, read the story for me so that I can go to sleep. But then sometimes mothers are busy with something. They talk on the phone, they watch Korean drama episode. Then the father take over. Okay? So the father actually tell them this story. He said, once upon a time, there was a mountain. Inside the mountain, there was a temple. Inside the temple, there was an old monk. And the old monk was telling a story. So the father asked the two children, do you know what story the old monk was telling? The two children said no. Do you want to know what the story was? They say yes. Then the father said, once upon a time, there was a mountain. Inside the mountain, there was a temple. Inside the temple, there was an old monk telling the story. Do you know what story the old monk was telling? The children say no. Do you want to know what story he was telling? He said yes. Once upon a time, so the anchor case is the children fall asleep, and then it stopped the recursion. So you learn recursive algorithm this way. At the moment, we are conducting some online training program for the secondary school student and JC student. If you really want to take part, you can also do it. You can go and we have this thing called the Junior Code Crunch. Okay, if you want, you can go and register an account in this, and then you can follow the tutorial, and then you can solve the task inside that. Okay, we divide them into three levels. Beginner, intermediate, and advanced. Okay, the intermediate one is actually our level. It's our level. So we are teaching them linked list, we are teaching them stack and queue and so on. Yeah, the advanced level is the CS 2010. So if you are interested in knowing some of the thing that you are supposed to study in 2010, you can go and take part in this. Read the tutorial and then do the task given, maybe for practice. Exactly the same as our take-home lab, the question inside there, you know, the format, the thing that you are supposed to do. So if you want, you can go and register an account and then start doing it. Okay, let's continue. Now I just briefly counted the number of students down here. We have only about 72, which is half of the class. What happened to the rest, to the other half? Stay at home. Okay, they think that webcast lecture. You know, there's the danger that they didn't record my voice. You know, sometimes the webcast lecture is not done properly, and then you will miss lecture. I don't know. Anyway, let's continue. Right, so this is a simple problem that you go and visit the ice cream store, and then they have many different flavor, and then you are allowed to choose only some of the flavor, maybe because you didn't bring enough money and the kind of things. Okay, so which are the two favor or which are the K favor that you want to choose? How many possible way of choosing those ice cream, yeah? Right, so we call this the N choose K kind of problem. Okay, N choose K kind of problem. So to me, I always tell students, okay, there are actually two kind of recursive algorithm, two kind of recursive problem. One is the one that we have seen before, where you break the problem down into smaller problem and the smaller problem is the same as the original problem, and then you know you just subtract by one, and then you just continue, okay, and so on. The other kind is what we call the N choose K problem. Okay, you can find a lot of this kind of example. You know, whether I choose this item or I don't choose this item. Okay, for example, we always send students to go for computation, right? So we have maybe, let's say, 20 students. And then we want to choose, like for example, maybe three teams of three students each. So I want to choose 9 students only. Okay, so from 20 students, I want to choose 9 students. How do I choose? And how do I form the teams? Okay, I will consider the first student, whether I want to choose him or not. If he's good, I put him into the teams, right? And then what happened? After chosen the first one, I will have 8 more students to choose, right? From the 19 students. If the first one is not good enough, I eliminated him, then I will have to choose 9 students out of the 19 remaining, right? So that is a possible problem like this. Okay, so I want to choose K out of N item. So as I described just now, I look at the first item. Okay, if I want to choose this item, then I will have K minus 1 to choose from N minus 1, right, and so on. Okay, if I don't choose the first item, then I will have, I still need to choose K item from N minus 1 item. Okay, what happens if N is equal to K? How many possible ways? I have to choose everybody, right? This is what happened in NUS. Our number of students interested in doing this or feel that they are good about doing computation is very few. You know, as compared to China, as compared to Russia, and the kind of thing, they have maybe millions of students, and they choose only 4. For us, we have 20 to choose 4. You just imagine, you know. Of course, when we go for computation, you are always not as good as them, lah. But we try, we make sure that give more training to our students. Hopefully their standard can go up. So if you have only 4 students to choose 4, what do you do? There's only one way, right? You have to take all 4 of them. There's only one way, right? What happens if you have no student and you have to choose 4? There's one way only, right? You cannot choose anybody, right? Okay? What happens if you have 4 students and you need to choose 5? Zero way. You cannot do it. Right? You cannot do it. Right. So you think about this, all the cases you have considered already. Then you just list out the cases and then you convert it to become an algorithm. So when K is equal to N, there's only one way. You choose everybody. Okay, you choose everything. When K is equal to 0, that means you do not need to do anything. There's only one way. If I choose the first one, then I have to choose K minus 1 out of N minus 1. Okay, to complete the task. Otherwise, if I don't choose the first one, then I need to choose K out of N minus 1. Okay? And notice that this is an or, right? Either I choose the first one or I don't choose the first one. Right? So the number of way down here and the number of way down here are exclusive. So therefore, if you add them up, it will give you the total number of ways. Okay? Meaning that for the first guy is not included and the first guy is included, they are different. So that will give you the total number of ways. Right, so we convince ourselves that this covers all the possible cases. And therefore, we see that this is actually a recursive call because this problem and this problem is exactly the same as the original problem. Right? Except that now, this one have less K and less N. This one have less N than the original problem. Okay? So if that's the case, we can implement this as a recursive algorithm easily. Right? That's it. Okay, you only have 3 lines or 4 lines of the statement to implement this problem, right? So if K is greater than N, I need 5, but I have only 4. That's impossible for me to do it, right? So I return 0. No way, yeah? Otherwise, if K is equal to N or K is equal to 0, I return 1 because there's only one way to do these two cases. Otherwise, I return this one plus this one. And that's it. This is the recursive algorithm for me to solve this problem, N choose K problem. Okay? Right, so this kind of problem can be modified. Like for example, you know, some of the supermarket or department store, they conduct this kind of lucky draw, right? So they say, oh, you want this prize, and you are given 10 minutes, and you know, you can go into the store and grab whatever thing that you want, right? If you can grab a diamond inside there, fine, you know, whatever you want. But there's this condition, 10 minutes. And maybe the other condition is they give you a bag. And then they say you can grab whatever you want and put it inside the bag. As long as the bag can hold, you can take it away. Okay? So those are the conditions. So the idea is there are so many items inside there. You have to go and decide whether I want to choose this item or not. If I choose this item, I put it inside the bag. The capacity of the bag is actually reduced, right? Then I will have to consider the other item. Yeah, and so on, right? So you have to make decision, choose and not choose. And then you go on to the next section, choose and not choose. Eventually you get the whole bag. But you want to maximize your value, right? So those will be the conditions that you want to put inside the parameter. Okay, so I can assure you that PE will be similar to this. Okay, you will have to consider all the different conditions, and then you have to decide what parameter you have for the recursive call. And once you decided that, the problem becomes very simple. Your implementation is very simple. Okay? So practice. We are going to give you a lot of practice questions. Right, so using that algorithm is actually similar to mathematics combination. How do you find combination out of so many items? Okay? You are not doing the permutation, it's combination. Yeah, so that's why it's C. Right, so C42 is equal to what? You know, right? In mathematics, but in computer science, you have to do it this way, right? So C42, because n is not equal to k is not equal to 0, so therefore you have to call 3-1 and 3-2, right? The two recursive call, and this is when you choose the first item, which is this guy, and this side is when you don't choose the item, yeah. And then you do the 3-1 first. So the same thing, out of three, I want to choose one. I have to do 2-0 and 2-1. This side, I choose this item, and this side I don't choose the item. Okay, so if I choose the item, I will just return 1 because now k is equal to 0. Hankel case, I return 1. And then I go to the side, I have to break it into 2 again because there are 2 items for me to decide. So this one is to choose the first item, this one is not to choose the first item. Yeah. So, and this one is 1, and this one 1. And then you go on to the other side and you do the same thing. Okay, and at the end, because of the recursive call, you are going to add them up, and the result will be the sum of all these things. Okay, because of the plus. Because of the plus, right? The answer to this one is actually equal to 6. Looking at this animation, you notice one thing. If you have 2 recursive call in the method, the system need to complete the first recursive call first before it go on to complete the second recursive call. Yeah? Did you notice it? You have to complete everything over this side first before you go on to the other side. The same thing when you are here. You are supposed to complete this side first before you go on to the second call. Okay, so this is how internal recursion work. In fact, as we say just now using the Tawa Hainoi, it is because this method or this recursive call is actually put in the bottom, right? And when you have this one, when it generates 2 recursive calls, this guy is down here and this guy is down here. So that's why when you pop it out, you have to finish this one first before you pop this one out, and so on. Okay, so that is the execution internally, okay? Right, so go forward to more computer science kind of problem, algorithmic problem. So what happens if I want to do searching on the sorted array, meaning that value inside this array is sorted, where either ascending or descending, it doesn't matter, right? So you say that in this case, because it is sorted, we can actually narrow the search space by half every time, okay, when we do the searching. So you say we can actually narrow the search space or more or less like eliminate half of it every time, okay? So given a sorted array of n elements and the integer x, I want to know whether x is inside A. If it is inside there, I return the index of this element, okay? That's what this problem is about. For example, A, the array is equal to this, and I want to search for 15, right? So what do you do? You first of all go to the middle. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right? So 8 plus 0 divided by 2 give you 4. So you go to here. You go to the middle, and then you check whether this value is equal to this value. If it is equal, you return 4. You return the index. Okay? If it is not equal, then you have to see whether I can find this value in the upper half or the lower half, because it's sorted, right? So you compare this value with this. 14 is smaller than 15. So you know that you can only search for, or you can only find, possibly find this value on the in the upper half, not the lower half. So therefore, you can eliminate all this, right? Then you go and look at this one. So it's 5 plus 8, 13 divided by 2 give you 6. So you're going to look at this. Okay, so now 15 is smaller than this. You go down to the lower half. And you are going to find that you are going to find this. And eventually, the x and y, the lower bound and the upper bound cross each other. You conclude that the value is not inside there. Okay, so you can cut down the search space by half every time. As compared to linear search, where you are supposed to go and look at every item starting from the front until you cannot find it, or you found it, then you stop. Okay, the worst case for this algorithm is O(n), because you need to look at all the elements. But if you have to divide by half, it is actually we call it log n. Okay, we will discuss this in the next lecture. Okay, so based on our description, again, you see, given an array, given this value, the lower bound and the higher bound, the upper bound, right? We need to know which part of this array we is to continue to search. Now we need to know, right? So this method is going to throw the item not found exception. Yeah? So low is the index of the lower value in the subarray, and high is the index of the highest value in the subarray. So because the second time you call, you're not starting from zero anymore, right? It could be starting from somewhere. So if low is greater than high, what does it mean? You know, if you have something like this, low is pointing here, high is pointing there. We say that these two indices are already close each other. It indicates that there's no more value that for you to search. So therefore, you throw this exception to say that it is not found. Otherwise, you find the midpoint, right? The midpoint, as I showed you just now, is to add the lower bound to the higher bound and then divide by 2. Okay, so that will be the midpoint. And then you compare your value with the element at this midpoint, right? If it is greater than the element in the midpoint, that means you have to search for it on the upper half, right? To go and search for it on the upper half, what do? You have to move your lower bound to mid plus 1. So the idea is, if this is mid, we know that we cannot find it down here. We want to start our search here. And so this is the lower bound for the what we call the active array. Yeah. So this is actually mid plus 1. And the high remains the high, the same as the one before. Okay? So we continue to search inside this range. Otherwise, if x is smaller, we know that we are supposed to search on the lower half or inside the lower half. So if that's the case, mid is down here. If we need to search in the lower half, the low will still be the same. The high of the news will be mid minus 1. You set the lower bound to mid minus 1. Right? So you continue to do this. Eventually, you found it, or the two indices will cross each other. Otherwise, you found it. You found it, you return the index of the midpoint. Okay, very simple. So in this case, you assume that the array is sorted ascending or descending? Ascending, okay, because the largest value behind. Yeah, so this is very simple. If it is sorted in descending, what do? Then you just change these two values, right? This one becomes smaller than, this one becomes greater than. Yeah, if it is sorted in descending order. Right, so you say starting function for recursion is hard to use this one for the user. Okay, the idea is that when the user give you the array and say, please tell me whether this value inside there, they don't care about the lower bound and the upper bound. They just tell you the array and say, please look for this element inside there. Okay, they don't care about the lower bound and upper bound. So therefore, it is hard to use this function at this is. Right? The user do not want to worry about the lower bound and upper bound. So what do? You do overloading, meaning that you create another method that only taking the array, taking the value. And then this method will call the one that we have just discussed, and set the lower bound and the upper bound to start. Okay, so something like that. So sometimes we call this the helper method. This is the original method that the user is going to use, because the user don't want to know what is the lower bound and the upper bound. Yeah. Right. So another problem that we required to solve is called the find the k smallest numbers in an unsorted array. Okay. If it is sorted, which one is the k smallest value? If it is sorted. Right. If it is sorted, then the k minus 1 would be the k smallest value, right? If it is sorted. Okay, but this is unsorted. So how do you find it? Of course, you say, oh, I do a pre-process, sort the thing. Then I will be able to say the k minus 1 is the k smallest one. Okay, but if you do that, sorting the complexity is actually n log n. So the question is whether I can do this faster than n log n. Okay, we are always concerned about efficiency. Okay, so this method actually gives you O n complexity to find the k smallest numbers. So how do you do it? We describe this algorithm first. So the idea is, first of all, I use the first item to be what we call a pivot. Okay, then I will partition the rest of the value into two parts, okay? Where inside this part are value that are less than or equal to pivot. So all the x inside here, if you call this p, everything inside here will be less than or equal to p. And everything over here will be greater than p. We try to partition it in this manner. That means you have to go through all the value and put them in the correct position. Okay, so that is what we call the partition method. Yeah, and after this, I will move this pivot to the middle. Okay, I will move this pivot to the middle. Right, for example, let's say I call this I. So P eventually become here. Then I will have to see if my P, the value, the k is actually equal to I minus 1. What does it indicate? I'm trying to look for the k smallest element. And after this partition and after moving the pivot to the middle, I know that I is pointing here. And k is actually equal to I minus 1. Or the other way around. No, sorry. I is equal to k minus 1. Then what can you talk about? What can you say about this p? P must be the k smallest element. Correct? Yeah? Because, like for example, this is I is 8, and then I want to look for the 7, 9. Wait. Yeah, it should be this guy. So, not this one. K equal to I minus 1. I was correct originally. So, like for example, I want to look for the 8 smallest element. And I is equal, I want to look for the 7 smallest element. And I want to look for the 8 smallest element, and then I is equal to 8. Then this one must be, I'm confused. I want to look for the 8 smallest. 8 smallest means the index must be 7, right? Because 0 to 7. So which one is correct? This one is correct. Yeah? So 7 is equal to 8 minus 1, yeah. So if this is the case, then we know that this pivot, this value that I use as a pivot to do the partition must be the k smallest value. Fine not? Okay? What happens if this is not the case? Meaning that I want to look for the 8 smallest value, but I is equal to 6. Which means I will have only 7 value down here. And so therefore, this 8 smallest value must be inside here. Yes? Then what do? I need to go and look for the first element inside here. Because I have 7 over here already. If I look for the smallest element over here, it will be the 8th element for the whole list, right? If, however, I is equal to 10, and I want to look for the 8 smallest. So that means I have 10 elements down here. This guy is not the 8 smallest. So the 8 smallest must be inside here. And what I need to do is I go and do the partition again on the first half. And whether you look at it on the first half or look at it on the second half, it's actually the same problem. Except that now, in the first half, you still look for the same the numbers. If it is on the second half, you have to say, you have to subtract in order to find which number you're supposed to look for in the second half. Otherwise, they are the same problem, right? Okay, so if that's the case, this is what you say. You choose this pivot, and then you do the partition. How? When we talk about sorting algorithm, we will talk about this partition. Just imagine that you have this method for you to use. Okay, you can do the partitioning, and then the method will return you the index for the pivot. Okay? And then what do you do? How do you put the thing that I described just now into here? Right, so this is again could be a multiple choice question. One is this, two is this, three is this, four is this, five is this. So what are the things that you want to put inside here? So if you look at it and the description that I had just now, this one is when I know that the pivot is the value that I'm looking for. Okay, so how do you tell that this pivot is actually the value that I'm looking for? It must be this guy, right? So I must be down here. Right? If the number of elements that I'm looking for is actually equal to the number of elements on the left side of the partition. I partition it into left and right. Okay, so if the number of elements on the left-hand side is equal to the number of k, then the last element inside this partition must be the value that I'm looking for. So you return what? You return p, right? So v should be down here. You found it, okay? Otherwise, you have to decide whether you want to continue to search on the left-hand side or search on the right-hand side. Right, so therefore, this value must be 2. The condition must be 2. Right, if k is less than the number on the left-hand side, that means you have to continue searching on the left-hand side. Right now, you want to find the fifth elements, but on the left-hand side, there are 8 elements. So therefore, you must search the fifth elements again on the left-hand side. So if that's the case, you are supposed to do number 3. Right, to search for the same k elements on the left-hand side. Otherwise, you have to go and search for the value on the right-hand side. But now, because you have so many elements on the left already, if I want to look for the 10 elements of overall, but there are 8 elements on the left-hand side, meaning that now I need to look at the second elements on the right-hand side. Yes? So therefore, you subtract k by the number of elements on the left, then you look for this element on the right. So therefore, you put this guy inside there. So that is an algorithm for you to find the k smallest elements inside the unsorted array. Okay, remember this is unsorted. If it's sorted, you do not need to do this. Okay, right? So we are still owe you one partition method. As I say, we will discuss this in sorting algorithm. Okay, another interesting problem, multiplying rabbits. Computer science can say this. In biology class, you cannot say this. Yeah? So in computer science, you can say this. You say that rabbit given birth to the rabbit or baby monthly, once they are 3 months old, okay? And they always give birth to a male and a female pair. That means they will give birth to 2 babies every time, every month. And one of them is male and the other one is female. Okay? And then after 3 months, they will be mature enough to produce. That's what you say. So if you convince yourself that this is possible in computer science, then the question is, if I give you a pair of rabbit, a female and a male, after N months, how many pairs or how many rabbits do you have after N months? And there's another assumption. It's not biology again. The rabbit never die. Where are they? Not inside here. Somewhere. Okay? So there's another condition. That means all these rabbits don't die. It will continue to produce and so on. So given one pair at the beginning, first month, second month, you still have one pair because they are not mature enough to produce, right? The third month, you will have the original pair plus the new pair, right? So therefore two. Okay, so therefore this is the new pair, right? And then the fourth month, you will have the original pair plus the new pair, and then the original pair will produce another pair, right? So therefore, this month you will have how many? Original pair and the new pair, and then they produce one more pair. Yeah? So this is a new pair of rabbit. Huh? This pair of rabbit is not mature enough to produce yet. So in the fourth month, you will have three pairs. Original, the baby in the previous month, the babies in this month. And then on the fifth month, this pair is mature enough to produce already. So they produce this new pair. And then the original pair produce this new pair. And then you have all the three pairs from the previous month. So total, you will have five pairs. And so on, yeah? And so on. The 6 months, you will have eight pairs. 7 months, you will have 13. 8 months, you will have 21. 9 months, you will have 34. And then 8 months, too many. So now the question is, what is this too many? How do you find this value? Of course, if you observe this sequence, what can you say? What is this sequence? 1 plus 1 equal to 2, 2 plus 1 plus 2 equal to 3, 3, 2 plus 3 equal to 5, 3 plus 5 equal to 8, and so on, right? So this is actually the famous Fibonacci, okay, too fast. This is the Fibonacci series. Right, so after looking at this, you can generalize it and say that, okay, the total number of rabbits in a certain month is actually rabbits in the previous month because they don't die. They all live, right? Plus the new baby that produced in this month. And the number of babies that can produce in this month is those rabbits that are already there 2 months ago, right? Because they are all mature enough to produce, including all the original one. So therefore, the new baby is actually equal to number of rabbits in n minus 2. Right, so if you think about it, you can have this sequence, and this sequence is called the Fibonacci sequence. Right, so if that's the case, we can actually formulate this as a recursive algorithm, very simple. When n is less than or equal to 2, we return 1, because if you look at this, when n is less than or equal to 2, we will just return 1, okay? Otherwise, when n is greater than 2, you are supposed to return the number of elements or number of rabbits in the previous month because they all survive, and the total number of rabbits produced by those rabbits that are 2 months ago, that they lived 2 months ago. Right, so that will be the Fibonacci sequence. Right, so you say that this is actually very elegant, but extremely inefficient. But okay, never mind. When I look at these Fibonacci numbers, these words, it always remind me of how I learned my English last time. I lived long time ago. And during our time, we had this thing called the Chinese school and the English school. And I belong to the Chinese school. Okay? Now don't have, right? All of you are English school. Okay? So sometimes the people call us the Chinese helicopter. Chinese helicopter, you know this term or not? Huh? You don't know this term, helicopter. Chinese educated. We are Chinese educated, but because we always pronounce words, things are not as good as the English educated, so they call us Chinese helicopter. So the problem is because, when now you learn Chinese, what do? You use Hanyu Pinyin, right? You use Hanyu Pinyin. Our time, we learn English using Hanyu Pinyin. Yeah. Those are people who are not Chinese. You are learning Chinese now, okay, in CS 1020. So when I was trying to pronounce this, I say, so it helped me to remember how to pronounce this. What is this? Huh? Minister. What is this? One more time, no. This is mosquito. You know, if you cannot pronounce in Chinese, you pronounce it in Teochew or Hokkien. This is mosquito. So you can find my pronunciation sometimes not very good. Okay, this is the consequence of how we learn Chinese. And the same thing for you, some of you, your Chinese is pronounced like a foreigner. Singaporean, yes or no? Yeah, because you learn Chinese using Hanyu Pinyin, it's the same thing. Yeah. Okay, so why is this inefficient? If you trace the recursive call for Fibonacci, to call to find Fibonacci 6, you need to find 5 and 4, right? Okay, because it's not less than equal to 2. So you go to this side, you can find 5 and you have to go and find 4 and 3. 4, you have to go and find 3 and 2. So remember, as I say, you have to finish the left-hand side first before you go on to the right-hand side. 3, you have to do 2 and 1. And all these are done already. 3, you have to go and do 2 and 1. Done, the anchor case. So you go on to the right-hand side, you have to do this, and you have to do this, okay? So by looking at this trace, this is what we call the tracing tree, yeah? You find that you are repeating some of the call over and over again, right? Many, many times. And this make this recursive call very inefficient because you are repeating all this computation over and over again, okay? And make this to become very inefficient. Of course, subsequently, when you go to CS 2010 or sometime maybe 3230, you will learn another technique called dynamic programming, DP. Okay, basically DP is to store whatever value that you have calculated before. And then when you need it again, you just use it without calling the method again. Okay, that's what DP is about. But these modules, we don't do it. Yeah, you do not need to worry about that one. So all these are duplicated, so therefore it's very inefficient. So sometimes if your submission cannot pass the code crunch test because of efficiency, then maybe sometimes you have to think about using iterative solution, right, to solve the problem. So you can see that if you use this recursive one, the method is only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines, okay? But if you have to use iterative again, in this case, we are not using stack to do it, just use 2 variables to remember the previous value. It can help you to solve the same problem more efficiently, okay? So in this case, I use the previous one and previous 2 to store the previous 2 values, and then the current one will be the new value. And then before I go on to the next iteration, I reset the previous 2 value. Right, so in this case, I'm using 2 variables to remember the previous value, similar to dynamic programming. But dynamic programming are normally recursive. But in this case, I'm using the iterative. Okay, so by doing this, you get the same solution, the same answer, but it is more efficient. Okay, so you say that which lines are the ones that make it more efficient? It's actually the whole thing down here, using this for loop, and then you store the previous 2 value. Okay. Right, then there are people who say even iterative, you have to do so much, and then they actually do some research, and then they found out that I can actually use this closed form solution to find the Fibonacci. And this is actually the formula. Very complicated. You have to use a mathematic power and the square root with some value called G, which is actually the golden ratio. You substitute all this value inside there, you will find the Fibonacci number for given n, right? So I'm not going to say how this is done. People have done research, okay, and come up with this. If you want to know, go and read this article. Right, so in nature, we can actually see that this Fibonacci number is actually very applicable by nature, right? So if you think about it, you know, flower like this, you actually have Fibonacci number inside there. And so on. Okay. Like for example, this. When it is picture, I cannot use this. Yeah. So inside here is actually similar to this thing. Okay. So you just go around and round and round. You actually create this shape down here. Okay, so the final example that we are going to give you is this thing called find the permutation of a string. Okay, so for example, given a word called east, I want to find all the possible permutation. Okay, for some of you, I think if you tell them this problem, they can do it easily. Okay, like for example, you tell your father how to permutate four numbers. They will tell you straight away 24 combination, because they buy 4D. Anyway, we do not know, okay? Let's say you do not know how to generate all the permutation. How do you do it? Right, so for example, this one, you can actually generate 24 permutations. Sometimes we call this permutation anagram, meaning that two strings are anagram if they have the same set of character but arranged in different order. We call them anagrams, okay? Palindrome is to say that if you look at the thing from left to right and from right to left, they are the same. That's palindrome, right? In this case, it's anagram. Right, so how do you generate using computer? So the idea is quite simple. Given this, it says that first of all, I can take out my AE and I try to go and generate all the combination of the next three character. And then I put my E in front of this generation. I mean this list of permutation that's generated, right? And after that, I can take out my A, and I go and generate all the permutation of these three character. And when they return, I will put my A in front of this permutation. I will get another six permutation. And after that, I will take out my S, and I go and generate permutation for EAT, and once they have done it, I will put the S in front of all this permutation. I will get another set of permutation. Finally, I will take out my T, and then I go and generate all the permutation of EAS. And when it is done, return to me, I put the T in front of it, I will have another set. Okay? So now the question is, how do I generate the permutation for three characters? To generate for four, this is the algorithm, right? Take out the first one, take out the second one, take out the third one, take out the fourth one. Go and generate the permutation for the rest of the three. Okay? So how do I do this? You say the same thing, right? I take out the A, I go and generate S and T. I take out S, I go and generate A and T. I take out T, I go and generate A and S. Okay? And then when they finish, I put the value inside. So finally, how do I do this? I take out A, I go and generate S. I take out the S, I go and generate A. And then I put the value back, right? And then you go back. So you can see that by saying things like this, each of the sub-problem is the same as the original problem, except that now the length of the string becomes smaller. Okay, so that's how you do it. The only thing is, because there are four characters inside the string, I need to do this four times. If there are three characters, I have to do it three times. If there are two characters, I have to do it two times. Okay, so therefore, this is not purely a recursive algorithm. You need to have a for loop inside there to take care of all these possible cases. Okay, so it looks something like this. Yeah, so this is the description that I said just now. And this is actually the algorithm, the program. So this is a beginning string. When you call, it's empty string. And then the string itself, we call it the ending string. Okay, so in this case, when you call, we're using the method, the example, this is EAST. Okay, so when it is equal to one character, that means we go down the recursive call already, at the end, we have only one character. You do not need to find permutation for one character, right? So you just return, okay? You just return, you print out this character itself. Otherwise, you have to use a for loop, as I say. If there are four characters in the string, you have to do it four times, taking out each character one at a time, right? So 0 to 3 in this case, 0 to 3, okay? And this new string is the one that you want to pass into the next call. You want to pass into the next call. So it's actually the ending string plus whatever is behind. Right, so when I is equal to 0, what is this? Substring 0 plus substring 0, 0 is what? It's empty string, okay? Substring 0, 0 is an empty string. And I send in what? I plus 1, so 0 plus 1 is equal to 1. I'm taking out the first character. I send in only three characters, correct or not? Starting from one, two, and three. So this guy actually take three characters. So the new string that you are going to send to the next recursive call is three characters. I have taken out the first character, okay? And then I go and call this permutation. I go and call this permutation again, right? So you can see that it is two parameters, the beginning string and the end string. So this new string is actually the end string, this one that I have just created, meaning that now I send in three characters for me to go and call the permutation, right? And this beginning string plus the first character, remember originally this is empty. So I plus the first character, like for example, EAST. So this guy, the second time I call, I'm sending in E, and then over here is actually AST. Understand this? So I'm calling this permutation again, the same method again, sending in this guy, which is actually the first character, and then calling the permutation to go and permutate three character, right? And when it is done, I will print, right? So this, the print down here is actually printing out whatever is this, and then the character written. So you are going to combine them together and print, okay? And then you go back to the for loop. The for loop I will become one. So if that's the case, 0 to 1, you take one character, right? So you have already taken out, just now taken out E, so you have to keep E inside there, plus ST. Right, so the new string will become EST, okay? And the beginning string is actually originally empty, plus character at one. Character at one is actually A. So now you are sending in A and then EST, which is the second group of permutation. You take the second character out and try to permutate the rest of the character in order to find the sixth combination. Can you understand this? And then the for loop will become, I become one, E become two. Then you are looking at this, take this out and then form this EAT. So now the begin string is this, and the new string is this. You call again, okay, and continue. Okay, so try to understand this. This combine recursion with some for loop, because you have so many cases to take care of. And for each case, you call it recursively. Okay, and you can generate the 24 permutation like that. So if you put in EASTS, five character, you are going to generate how many permutation? I don't know, you have to go and find. Okay? Right, finally, I just want to mention this. Backtracking is a very important technique in computer science. Together with recursion, you can actually solve a lot of problems. Okay, backtracking. One of the, classical problem is actually traversing a maze. Right, so when you hit the date end, you are supposed to backtrack to the previous one. So include using backtracking plus recursion, you can actually solve quite a lot of problems. Okay, searching problem and all those things, right? So you say recursion and stack illustrate the concept of backtracking. You use stack to remember where is the previous junction. Okay, like for example, in the maze, you can go two places. If I decided to go here, I will put this on the stack. Right, and if this is a dead end, I will just pop and then I will straight away come back to here, like teleporting. I go back to the junction and then continue searching on the other path. Yeah, so this is combining recursion and stack to do backtracking. And you can actually use this to solve a lot of searching problem. Problem that involve searching. You can use this. Okay, so we are not going to talk about backtracking down here, but I just tell you that this is an important technique that you should learn. So, it will be covered in the more advanced courses, okay? Right, so I think the summary is just to ask you whether you have understood everything down here. Using the example, you have already understood the recursive algorithm and so on. Okay, remember, take picture, you do this.